seated.
I understand. We're still waiting. Oh, great. Okay, they've just come in. I got it.
Sorry, Your Honor. I'm ready when you are. I apologize for the delay.
That's okay. I just understood that the defense needed to see the court, so I figured I would get ready.
Certainly.
So when you're ready.
If I could just grab one quick file, I'll be right there.
Counsel Pooch? Tunia Gotti, are we ready?
We are.
Okay.
We may need a tech minute later on for other witnesses, but that shouldn't stop us.
All right. Everybody ready? Tunia Smith, ready to go?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Chief Brooks? All right, please bring in the jurors. All rise for the jurors, please. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You may be seated. State may call its next witness.
Your Honor, the state calls Douglas Small. Please.
Can you?
I see him right over there. Got it.
Yes, sir.
Oh, right here.
Just watch your step, Mr. Small.
They don't expand. Thank you.
You need to be in front of a microphone. Mr. Small?
Yes.
Can you hear?
Yes.
Okay. Please remain in front of the microphone.
Yes, Your Honor. Mr. Small, if you could stand and raise your right hand, I'm going to administer an oath. Are you able to hear me clearly?
Reasonably.
Okay. Do you swear that the testimony that you're about to provide this jury will be the truth and the whole truth under the pains and penalties of perjury?
I do.
Thank you. You can have a seat and you can make yourself comfortable, sir. When you're ready, if you can start by stating and spelling your full name for the record.
My name is Douglas Small, D-O-U-G-L-A-S-S-M-A-L-L.
And Mr. Small, forgive me for asking, but how old are you, sir?
85.
And what city and state do you currently reside in?
Carmel, Maine.
How long have you lived in Carmel, Maine?
All my life.
And sir, what do you currently do for a living?
Well, I'm semi-retired, but I have rental houses and I maintain those.
And you maintain them. Do you do roofing on those houses?
And siding, anything that needs to be done.
At 85?
That's right.
What are other...
I don't do it all myself.
Okay. What are other positions that you've held in the past in terms of employment?
Boy, just about everything going. I learned at a young age, if you're going to live in the state of Maine, you've got to do just about everything. Unless you have an education.
Okay. Do you own any properties in Carmel, Maine?
I do.
And can you describe those for the jurors, please?
They're just, they're all one family residential homes.
Do you own any large parcels of land?
I have two properties that encompass about 30 acres each.
Is there an old schoolhouse on one of those?
There is.
Is there an old outhouse on one of those properties?
That's the old outhouse that you speak of is in the old schoolhouse. It's a one-room school.
Your Honor, may I approach this witness? I'll speak into a mic.
Yes, you may.
Mr. Small, I'm going to ask, do you know someone named Kelsey Small?
She was my granddaughter.
Okay, and you say she was your granddaughter?
Correct.
Where is she now?
She's in an urn in the cemetery in Carmel, Maine.
Again, I'm sorry to ask this, sir, but when did your granddaughter, when did she pass away?
In March of 22.
So, Mr. Small, I'm showing you what's been marked as State's Exhibit 65. I'm just going to ask if you recognize any of the individuals in this photograph.
It looks like Adam Montgomery in the rear, but I honestly couldn't state that to be a fact.
Okay. And if I can have. Mr. Small, I'm showing you it's been marked as State's Exhibit 90. Do you recognize the individual depicted in this photograph?
I'd have to have it a little closer.
You can handle it.
Thank you.
It certainly looks like Kelsey on the lower bottom.
Kelsey Small?
Kelsey Small.
Okay. I can take that back, sir. You mentioned Adam Montgomery. Are you familiar with Mr. Montgomery?
He stayed at my home for several weeks.
Your Honor, may I approach you?
Yes, ma'am.
So, Mr. Small, I'm showing you it's been marked as State's Exhibit 101. Do you recognize the individual depicted in this?
It looks like Adam.
Adam Montgomery?
Yes.
And you said that Mr. Montgomery stayed at your home?
That's correct.
How long did he stay at your home for, Mr. Small?
There were two periods, and I don't know the date that he arrived the first time, but I drove to Rochester to pick both he and Kelsey up, I believe, on the 11th of November of 21.
Of 2021. And are you aware of Mr. Montgomery, the defendant in this case, staying with other family members of yours?
No, he was at my house both periods.
Do you recall him staying with your daughter, Bessie Small?
There was one night that perhaps, that's my daughter-in-law, but I'm not sure. I go to bed early. Whether he actually stayed overnight or not, I couldn't swear.
Mr. Small, did you ever loan the defendant one of your vehicles?
No.
And how about your granddaughter, Kelsey?
I let her have my Pontiac. Okay.
And specifically with respect to late 2021, did you lend Ms. Small that Pontiac that you just mentioned?
I told them they could have it to go to Manchester with, yes.
To come to Manchester?
Yes.
And you mentioned that it's a Pontiac, but can you describe it for the jurors, the make model, if you're able to?
Yeah, it's an old one. It's an 06 Grand Prix.
Do you know the color?
I would call it gray.
Mr. Small, with respect to the properties that you own in Maine, are you aware of searches that were conducted on those properties?
There was one day when a group of detectives, or at least police people, came and went through the old schoolhouse.
Do you know what they were searching for?
At the time, I didn't.
Do you know now?
Well, I suspect that, no,
objection.
I don't know.
For safe basis.
But
hold on, sir. Hold on one moment, please. There's an objection. Hearsay.
Your Honor, so I have a longer response for that. I don't know.
All right. If you have a speaking objection, please approach.
Mr. Small, do you recall how many detectives were present that day?
Couldn't swear to them. Four, I believe.
And how long were they there searching?
Oh, in the building itself.
The building and the property?
Yeah. I'd guess that a half hour.
Thank you, Mr. Small. No additional questions for you, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Small. I do not have any questions.
Your Honor, I'd ask that this witness be excused.
Without objection.
All right, sir, you may be excused, so I'll ask you just remove your headphones, please. You can just leave them there. We'll take care of them.
Thank you.
Be careful of the wires.
Your Honor, the state calls Trooper Bryan Hernandez.
Thank you.
Trooper Hernandez, if you would remain standing and just raise your right hand. Do you swear that the testimony that you're about to provide this jury will be the truth? Whole truth under the pains and penalties of perjury?
I do.
You can have a seat, make yourself comfortable.
Good morning, Your Honor.
And when you're ready, if you can just start by stating and spelling your full name for the record.
So I'm Mass State Trooper Bryan Hernandez. First name I spell B-R-Y-A-N. Last name I spell H-E-R-N-A-N-D-E-Z.
Thank you, Trooper. Obviously, I've called you Trooper. Can you tell these jurors what you currently do for a living?
So I am employed with the Massachusetts State Police. I am currently a detective with the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office.
And sir, I'm just gonna ask you to keep your voice up. It's a big room and all the jurors need to be able to hear you.
Hold it, Your Honor.
Just imagine talking to the back of the room. Can you tell us how long you've been so employed?
So I've been employed with the Mass State Police since 2020. 2020, it's about going on 4 years now. Previously, I was a city cop for the city of Chelsea in Massachusetts. That was from 2014 to 2020.
Prior to 2014, any law enforcement experience?
Prior to 2014, no.
Okay. And as far as your current duties and assignments, can you tell the jurors about that?
Yes, I'm currently employed with the Suffolk State Police Detective Unit. We handle homicides, we do major felony crimes as well.
Do you assist in missing person cases?
Occasionally, yes.
Detective, if you can, so during the course of your career as a detective with the Mass State Police, did you become involved in the investigation into the disappearance and murder of Harmony Montgomery?
Yes.
And can you explain to these jurors just your role and participation generally in the case?
Yes, with this case, Manchester PD reached out to Mass State Police. They had areas of interest that they wanted to conduct searches. So they reached out to the Suffolk County District Attorney's office, which we handled as investigators. It was up to me to kind of coordinate with other Mass State Police units, including the Special Emergency Response Team, which is also known as the SERT Team, and other Mass State Police units as well.
Did you act as a liaison between the Mass State Police and the Manchester Police Department.
And Attorney Knowles, I'm going to ask you as well to please keep your voice up.
Thank you.
Yes.
If I can have just a moment, Your Honor. And Trooper, if you can just tell us, when did your involvement in this matter begin?
It began early September 2022.
During your involvement in this case, did you receive certain toll records related to this matter?
Yes.
Your Honor, may I approach this witness?
Yes, you may.
Trooper Hernandez, I'm showing you what's been marked as State's Exhibits 100A through 100U. And I'm just going to ask that you look at each of those in turn and look up when you're done. Thank you, Trooper. Are you familiar with the items depicted in that?
Yes.
Sorry. Are they fair and accurate based on your memory of the records that you reviewed?
Yes.
Your Honor, the state moves to strike what's been marked for identification as State's 100A through U and marked as full and published to the jury.
Without objection.
All right. The ID is stricken. They are entered as a full exhibits, and they may be published to the jury.
Thank you. And Your Honor, if we may approach briefly.
Yes. Wait, Attorney Smith?
Apologies, Trooper. Would using maps to discuss these locations that you searched, the toll information, would that assist these jurors in understanding the locations that you're describing?
Okay.
Do you believe that maps would assist?
Yes.
Your Honor, may I approach?
Yes, you may.
So, Trooper Hernandez, I'm showing you what's been marked for identification as State's Exhibits 145 through 155. If you could just review each of those, and look after your time.
Thank you, Trooper. The areas that you just reviewed, are you familiar with those areas?
Yes.
And is that through your capacity as a law enforcement officer with the Mass State Police?
Yes.
And the records that were just admitted through you, you're familiar with those as well?
Yes.
And again, the maps that you just reviewed, those would help the jurors in understanding the locations that we're going to discuss?
Yes.
Your Honor, I move to publish what's been marked for identification as State's Exhibit 145 through 155.
So if you want to use those as demonstrative exhibits, you may do so. They're not marked as full exhibits, but they
Thank
may
you.
Be shown.
So Trooper Hernandez, turning to the toll information, please look at the screen behind you. And if you can just confirm, other than the red sticker on the bottom of the exhibits that you just were handed, is that consistent with what's before you?
Yes.
And what is the image in the top right of that picture? What does it capture?
The license plate.
And can you please read the license plate number of that vehicle, and I'll make it large for you.
So it's Arizona registration, AJ78147.
And I think you said this, but it's an Arizona registration?
Correct.
What are the dates and times associated with the violations?
The dates are March 4th, 2020. Times are 4 in the morning at 4:44 a.m. And underneath that same date, March 4th, 2020, it's at 4:45 a.m. The one underneath that one is March 4th, 2020 at 5:25 a.m.
And what are the toll, the exit plazas associated with the toll violations?
Tobin Bridge.
And any specific directions associated with the tolls?
So Tobin Bridge Local North, Tobin Bridge Local South, Tobin Bridge Local North.
So you've testified that the maps would assist jurors in understanding these specific locations. And I'm going to place a map on the screen behind you. If you could look at that for a moment, and that should be consistent with State's Exhibit, what's marked as State's Exhibit 145 for identification. Do you recognize the area depicted in this image?
Yes.
And if you could just describe what the jurors are seeing in this image.
So it's the Tobin Bridge. That's where, would you like for me to point?
Yeah, if you don't mind, just, and you can get up if you need to, if you can point out the Tobin Bridge area.
Tobin Bridge is in this vicinity right here.
And for those unfamiliar, how would you describe the Tobin Bridge area?
Tobin Bridge is, it has tolls, easy pass tolls where it documents when a vehicle goes by it. It's a very, it's a high traveled highway. Bridge that leads into like the Boston area into Chelsea.
And you said it leads into the Boston area and Chelsea?
Correct.
Would you say that the Tobin Bridge area is suspended over water, ground, both?
Over water.
Do you know how around how long it is?
Not sure.
So let's look at the area associated with the tolls. And the zoomed in area. Can you describe what's depicted in this image?
That's where the Easy Pass readers are located. In this vicinity.
And that image is associated with which toll area?
Tobin Bridge.
All right, and how about this image? Sure.
That is also part of the Tobin Bridge as well.
Okay, and if you don't mind just pointing to the area. And the area that you just pointed to, is that a specific toll?
Correct.
And this one?
Same with this. This is a toll as well, Tobin Bridge area.
So, Trooper, I'd like to discuss specific searches that your unit conducted related to this case, the search for the body of Harmony Montgomery. Can you just discuss the Massachusetts Special Emergency Response Team, or CERT?
You want me to, could you just repeat that one more time? I'm sorry.
Can you just discuss the CERT team, the CERT team for Massachusetts?
So the CERT team, which is the Special Emergency Response Team, they specialize in conducting searches for all sorts of reasons. They assisted in this. They were a major part in this. They normally go out with, they went out with us this time, and they were the ones that were tracking down locations where we were searching, essentially.
Specifically with the CERT team, do they search a particular area, water, land, air, all?
All.
So they have access to to airplanes, helicopters?
Yes, some of the units that the CERT team uses are K-9. They use Massachusetts Dive Team as well, the Mass State Police Air Wing Unit.
And can you please describe for the jurors just the searches that were conducted by the CERT team, again, looking for the body of Harmony Montgomery?
Would you like the locations?
Yeah. And I'll actually put them up on the screen behind you. So if you can discuss, beginning with Route 101 near the Tobin Bridge, and that search location.
So the 107, Route 107, that was done, that was conducted from the area of Revere to the Saugus line, both Revere is a city and town, and the Saugus as well. So that vicinity of 107 was conducted by the CERT team.
And can you just point that area out on the map behind you, please? How about Broad Sound Tuna Club area?
That was conducted also by the CERT team, which is this vicinity right here. Dive team also assisted.
The dive team also assisted. How about canines? Were they present for that?
Not sure if canine was present that day.
Okay. Are you familiar with a search of the Sales Creek area?
Yes.
To the search for the body of Harmony Montgomery?
Correct.
Yes. And can you point that out on the map as well?
This vicinity right here.
Bridge Pizzeria area. Are you familiar with a search conducted by the CERT team, again, related to this case?
Yes, that was done in Revere, the city of Revere.
And you said specifically in Revere?
Correct.
How about the marsh on the, well, there it is on the map.
Mm-hmm.
Are you familiar with this search?
Yes.
And can you just describe it to the jurors, please?
So the marsh area that was searched was this vicinity right here, along with also this vicinity here. It's a large area.
And what went into that search?
It was split up in multiple days, in 2 days. With that, it was a lot of law enforcement personnel from Manchester PD. Also, detectives from other counties, because it went into the Essex County, which is Saugus. The CERT team as well, along with K-9.
And so in your role, your involvement in this case, how do you set up a search like this?
So it's pretty much wherever the PD is interested in searching. At this point, it was Manchester PD had locations of interest. Based off of that, I relayed that information over to the commander for the CERT team, which is Lieutenant Kevin O'Hara. He's the one that got the additional units to kind of assist with it.
And I think you said this already, but there were multiple agencies present for these searches, is that right?
Correct.
State and federal?
Correct.
The searches that you participated in, how long did those last typically?
So the marsh area was a very big area. The Rumney Marsh Reservation, it lasted about 8 hours each day, and it was done within 2 days.
Each day it was about 8 hours?
Yes.
How many individuals participated, roughly?
Roughly, easily over 30 law enforcement.
Detective Hernandez, I want to turn your attention to a specific search in this case. That's the area of Rumney Marsh in Revere. Are you familiar with the search of that location?
Yes.
And can you tell the jurors about the search of that specific location?
Yeah, Rumney Marsh is wetland. There's a lot of grass, tall grass there. And that was done, like I said, that was done on 2 days. We split them up in 2 days. One of the days was on September 18th, 2022, my apologies. And the following search was conducted in April 7th, 2023.
Okay, so two specific days, September 18th, 22, and April 7th of 23. And can you point the specific locations out for each of the searches on the map?
Yes. So one of the areas was right here, close to Copeland Circle and Revere. Another one was right in this vicinity right here, which would be right behind the Northgate Plaza in Revere as well. And
this area right here was conducted as well, which that was, goes into the town of Saugus.
And Trooper Hernandez, can you just describe the towns that, that are bordering that area, that, that are surrounding the areas of those searches?
The areas, so it's the city of Revere, borders the, was one of the areas where it's conducted the searches, and also the town of Saugus.
You mentioned the Tobin letting out or leading to Chelsea?
Yes.
How far is Chelsea from the Revere area?
Chelsea is about 10 minutes away from Revere. 10, 15 minutes away from Revere.
During any of these searches, was the body of Army Montgomery located?
No.
Thank you, Trooper Hernandez. No additional questions for you, sir.
Thank you.
Good morning. I have no questions, Trooper.
Good morning, sir. Thank you.
Your Honor, I'd ask that this witness be excused.
Any objection?
No objection, Judge.
All right, sir, you may step down. You are excused.
Thank you so much, Your Honor.
Your Honor, if we could approach on the next witness, please.
Yes.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it looks like we're going to have to take short recess. We will bring you in as soon as we can. Don't discuss the case with each other or with anybody else. Don't do any independent research. Don't look up any locations on the maps. And as I say, we will bring you back as soon as we can. Thank you.
All rise for the jury.
All right, counsel, approach for That's what I mean.
It's a marathon.
Huh?
It's a marathon, for sure.
Everybody ready?
We are, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor. And Ms., the next witness is up here. We're just going to bring her in once the jury's seated. Yes?
Yes, Your Honor, please.
All right. All rise for the jurors, please. Please be seated. State may call its next witness.
Thank you, Your Honor. At this time, the state would call Ms. Rebecca Maines to the stand, please. Good morning, Ms. Maines. If you would go right over to where the bailiff is, please, and watch your step on the cords.
Just be careful of the cords, please.
And Ms. Maines, if you would remain standing and please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you give this jury will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you. Please feel free to have a seat. There's water there if you would like it at any point in time, okay? Ms. Maines, because we're being recorded here today, would you please state your full name and spell both your first name and your last name for the record?
Yeah, my name is Rebecca, R-E-B-E-C-C-A, and my last name is Maines, M-A-I-N-E-S.
And Ms. Maines, you reside in New Hampshire, correct?
I do.
How long have you been a New Hampshire resident?
49 years.
49 years. Currently, it's my understanding that you're staying at the New Hampshire State Prison for Women. Is that correct?
I am back on a parole violation, yes.
Okay. And what is your anticipated release date?
April 15th.
Okay. And just to get this out of the way, with regards to previous convictions that you've had, it's my understanding you've had convictions for a series of theft by unauthorized takings and a one count of credit card fraud all between 2016 and 2019. Is that correct?
That is correct.
During that time period between 2016 and 2019, what were you battling with?
I'm a heroin addict.
Okay. And how long have you been in recovery?
10 months today.
Congratulations on
Thank
that. With regards to your work history, prior to using heroin, what sort of jobs did you hold?
I was in the medical field.
And what did you do in the medical field?
I was a nurse.
Do you know a person by the name of Adam Montgomery?
I do.
Okay. Where did you first meet Adam Montgomery?
I met him in Manchester in 2022. We were both part of the Sober Community.
Sober Community?
Correct.
I'm going to show you what's Mamari Steaks Exhibit 101. I see that you're nodding your head. Do you
it's
recognize
Adam.
This person?
It's Adam.
That's Adam Montgomery?
It is.
And back in, did you meet him back in 2021?
21, yes. I'm sorry.
Right.
Yes.
How would you describe your relationship? How much did you spend time together?
Every day.
Every day.
I would have called him my best friend.
Did you have a car at that time?
I did.
Okay. And what kind of car was it?
It was a 2017 Ford Fusion.
Okay. And do you know whether the defendant had a car at that time?
He did not.
You said that you were best friends. Would you ever travel together?
We did.
Okay. And what town did you grow up in?
Portsmouth.
Okay. Did you ever take him to Portsmouth?
No, we Hampton.
Hampton.
Was the furthest.
Okay. And what town did he grow up in?
I want to say Lynn, Massachusetts. I know it's down, it's Revere. I believe it's Revere. I know it's down in that area.
Okay. Did you ever talk with him about his children, how many children he has?
Yes.
Okay. What, if anything, did he ever tell you about how many children he had?
Well, I'm pretty sure I told you guys five, but I, thinking about it, I know he had four.
You know he had four?
Correct.
And when you say you guys, are you referring to investigators?
When I spoke with the state, yes.
Okay.
With you and...
About to say, this is not the first time you and I've met, is it?
No, it is not.
Okay. And where did we meet?
At the New Hampshire State Prison for Women.
And what did we talk about that day?
We talked about my statement.
Okay. And do you remember what you were told to do when you were testifying?
Yes.
Okay. What were the three rules of testifying that we talked about?
Speak loud, mm-hmm. Tell the truth, and I don't remember.
Okay.
Stare at you guys.
I say, does it sound like one of the other things was to make sure you use your own words in whatever your testimony
absolutely.
Is?
Yes. Okay. Sorry.
All right. It's all right. At the time in 2021, did you ever talk with Adam Montgomery about a daughter named Harmony?
I did.
Okay. Where did he say she was living in 2021 when you talked with him?
He told me that he dropped her off to her mother in 2019 at a rest area.
What did he say about how often he was seeing her back in 2021?
He said her mother would not allow him to see her and that he had been trying for some time.
What, if anything, did he say to you about her having any sort of toilet problems or bathroom issues before she went to live with her mother?
He said she was constantly wetting her pants or using the bathroom. He put her in the corner in her soiled pants. But that she would repeat it when she'd get in the car. She'd have an accident, but he said it was on purpose.
On purpose?
Yes.
That's what he said?
Correct.
What did he say about why he decided to send Harmony back to her mother?
Because she continually shit her pants. Sorry.
That's okay. Are those his words?
Yes.
Okay. Then those are his words. Remember, one of the things is to make sure that you always tell the truth, correct? You just took an oath a moment ago to tell the
truth.
All right. With regards, again, to his words, did he ever tell you about a physical incident between himself and Harmony?
He did.
What did he say in his words that you recall?
So he told me that... he was in the bathroom, or the kids were in the bathroom. I don't remember the But he was in the bathroom and he had walked out to find Harmony with her hands over the baby's mouth and nose, and that the baby was not breathing and turning blue, and he said he saw red and he just backhanded her.
So he told you that he backhanded her?
Correct.
And when she was holding her hand over, you said the baby's mouth, did he tell you which baby, which of his other children?
You know what he did, but I don't remember. I want to say Declan, but I'm not 100% positive.
Don't want you to guess. So if you remember, you remember, and if you don't, you don't. That's okay. Do you remember the name of the child that he was talking about, the baby?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was Declan.
Okay. And did he say where he was living when he hit Harmony in the mouth after seeing her cover this child's mouth?
Probably. I don't recall.
Don't recall. Okay. Did you say when it was? Specifically when in the year? Spring, summer, fall,
it was
winter?
Right before he returned Harmony to her mother.
Right before? Did he, let me ask you, did you ever give him a ride to Maine?
I did not give him a ride.
Okay, so you did not give him a ride to Maine?
No.
All right. Do you know what state he was living in at the end of 2021?
Yes, he was in Maine.
Okay. Do you know who he was living with?
He was living with Kelsey.
Did you ever meet Kelsey?
She, again, is one of my, was one of my really good friends.
Okay. And what was Kelsey's last name?
Small.
Finally, with regards to what the defendant stated to you about Harmony, what, if anything, did he ever say, or I'm sorry, who, if anyone, did he ever say Harmony reminded him of?
Her mother.
Her mother?
Her mother.
And did he tell you how that made him feel? God bless you.
He said he hated her, right to his core.
Ms. Means, you stated a moment ago that the defendant indicated or said to you that he hated Harmony's mother. Is that correct?
No.
Oh, who did he hate?
Harmony.
He hated Harmony.
Yes.
You should approach Judge. Drawn.
Just a moment, please, Your Honor.
Yes.
This means I just want to make sure that I'm understanding this clearly. So your testimony is Adam Montgomery told you that he hated his daughter. Did he say why?
She reminded him of her mother.
So not that he, so your testimony isn't that he hated her mother, it's that he hated Harmony.
Correct.
Because she reminded him of
her mother.
His mother. And at that point, I have no further questions for Ms. Means. I thank you very much for your time. I believe defense counsel will have a few.
Good morning, Ms. Maines.
Good morning.
I believe we met briefly just a few minutes ago, but again, I'm Jamie Brooks, and I represent Mr. Montgomery. I'm also going to be asking you some questions.
Okay.
And I want to begin by asking you about your criminal record, specifically your convictions between 2014 and 2019.
Okay.
You have 11 separate felony convictions?
Probably. I was a drug addict.
And along with that 11, you have 7 separate misdemeanor convictions, right?
Probably.
For credit card fraud?
Probably.
Specifically, just to dive into the details a bit, 2014, theft, Rockingham County, correct?
Correct. I'm going to agree with you on all these charges. I don't know that we need to go through all of them.
2016, theft.
I'm a criminal, sir, yes.
Rockingham County.
Yeah.
2016, theft by deception. Rockingham County.
If you say so. I am a criminal.
2016, 3 separate convictions for felony level theft out of Marybeck County.
If you say so. I don't have the documentation in front of me. I don't need it either. I am a criminal. I don't have a problem telling you that.
2017, theft, Merrimack, right?
Yeah.
2018, another theft, felony level out of Merrimack.
Yep.
2018, a theft out of Merrimack.
I believe it was all the same incident, correct?
Would you like to see the charges?
No.
With different docket numbers?
No. I'm telling you I'm a criminal. I don't know why that would make a difference.
And you also have 2 theft convictions out of Rockingham County in 2019.
Correct.
You indicated on direct examination that you were with Adam for a couple of months?
Yes.
Beginning around August of 2019?
Correct.
Or my apologies, August of 2021.
2021, I'm sorry, yes.
And you and Adam were together essentially every day?
Right up until I moved back to the seacoast.
You considered him a best friend?
I would have, yes.
He ended up moving to Maine to be with Kelsey Small, correct?
Well, he ended up going there, yes.
You were the one who introduced Adam and Kelsey in the first place?
I was.
I want to talk with you a bit about your current legal situation. You indicated that you are eligible to be released on parole in April?
Correct.
In a couple of months?
Mm-hmm.
But it's also fair to say that that is not the extent of your legal troubles, correct?
Correct.
You are presently facing three sets of charges out of three separate counties, correct?
Actually, it's four.
There's a fourth?
Yes.
Okay. Let's start with Merrimack County.
None of these I've been convicted of, so they're none I would talk about. I have the legal right to that.
I'm not going to ask you about the specifics, but I am going to ask you about the fact that you are, in fact, presently being charged with...
I'm not facing any more time, sir. I'm not doing any more time.
Well, let's talk about that. You're facing a Class B felony offense out of Merrimack County, correct?
I don't know if it's a... It's for possession of crack cocaine. I believe it's going to be a misdemeanor.
You have two counts of possession of Merrimack County, correct?
No. Do I? No, I don't believe so.
Are you familiar with a document called a case summary?
Yes.
Would looking at that case summary assist you in knowing what you're charged with?
Yeah, I actually...
Permission to approach, Your Honor?
Yes, you may.
I'm now handing you what is a case summary for your current pending Merrimack County Superior Court case.
Okay.
Having reviewed that, does that help refresh your recollection?
No, I was only aware of one.
But you are, in fact, facing two.
Apparently you say so, yes.
And those are two... happy to take that back if you want, unless you need to look at it again.
No, I don't need it. I don't have a problem telling you that.
So in Merrimack County alone, you are still presently facing two charges carrying a maximum penalty of 3.5 to 7 years in prison.
Yes.
And there is a second court, correct?
Yes.
And that's Rockingham County Superior Court.
Yes.
And out of Rockingham County Superior Court, you're facing an A felony offense.
I am.
That carries a maximum penalty itself of 7.5 to 15 years.
Yes.
You also have a charge right here out of this very court, correct?
Mm-hmm. I do.
Itself a Class B felony.
Mm-hmm.
Itself punishable by up to 3.5 to 7 years.
It is.
And you indicated that there's a fourth?
I'm correct. Out of Bedford, I have possession of crack cocaine.
When did that charge come about?
I was arrested on August 12th of 2022.
That would also be a felony level offense?
It is a misdemeanor.
Okay.
Acts prohibited, I believe, or notes.
And even though you're scheduled for release in April on the sentence you're presently serving, those charges are all still pending?
They are still pending, yes.
And there is an additional problem as well, right? In each of those three cases, you failed to appear for court?
I did. I was, and that's not a problem at all. I was in treatment, sir.
You were on the lam?
I was in treatment, sir.
Absconded from your parole?
I was in, I was in treatment, sir.
Yet your parole did not know you were in treatment and a warrant was issued?
I believe I've answered that question. And they did know where I was. But thank you.
And you would agree that failing to appear for court is itself also potentially a crime?
It is a crime, yes.
Bail jumping?
I was not charged with bail jumping, sir.
You haven't been charged with bail jumping yet since being arrested?
I was in treatment, sir, and I'm pretty sure that I verified that through the courts, and each of them know.
I want to change topics.
My criminal record?
Adam fought for 4 years to get Harmony?
Adam fought for 4 years? I mean, if you say so.
You don't recall telling the police that?
I didn't tell the police he fought for 4 years.
Let's talk about, you indicated something about standing in a corner.
I did.
She would stand in a corner and poop? Is that something that you said?
I said that she used the bathroom in her pants and he put her in the corner.
Okay, so we're not talking about the car.
No, I'm not. I didn't say anything about the car.
Okay, so this is something that would occur when they were living in a home or an apartment or something.
Correct.
Like that. So, Ms. Maines, on direct examination, it was elicited that you have met with the state before, correct?
I did, yes.
And one of those times that you met with the state was when you were in prison?
Yes.
And that was January 4th of 2023?
Probably.
But it was another time that you were incarcerated. You since got out.
Yes.
During some point of 2023, and now you're back.
Correct.
Okay. You recall being interviewed by a Detective Dunleavy?
I was, yes.
And you were wanting to get out of your situation, correct?
No.
You were in prison.
So?
You wanted to stay in prison?
I was there on parole. Nothing you can do can help me with parole, sir.
Do you recall telling Detective Dunleavy that you wanted to have a recorded telephone conversation with Mr. Montgomery?
No, that I wanted to have a recorded conversation? Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. You never told Detective Dunleavy that?
No. I actually told him I wanted to see him in person.
Well, you did say that, too. You wanted to go and visit Adam at Valley Street Jail, right?
I have been in contact with him while he has been incarcerated, sir.
At the time, Adam was at Valley Street Jail when you were at the Women's State Prison mm-hmm. in January of 2023.
Correct.
And you told Detective Dunleavy, I would like to go and visit him at Valley Street.
I did. Adam was a really good friend of mine.
But you also told him that you couldn't do it by yourself, right?
I will never see Adam again because I'm a criminal, sir, which means I can't get into the jails or the prisons.
You told Detective Dunleavy that you would like to go and visit Adam at the prison, but you needed their help to do so, right?
Oh. I needed their help? Absolutely not.
Being incarcerated, you would agree that you would not be able to get to Valley Street on your own, right?
Correct.
You would have to be released with the assistance of the police.
No, absolutely. I was on parole, sir. You don't get to be released just because the police said so.
You told the police that you had nothing to lose?
What? I want to see that because I'd never said that.
While we're on the topic, at the very end of the conversation with Detective Dunleavy, Detective Dunleavy asked, do you have anything else for us? And your response was, I can tell you all about drugs, right?
No, absolutely not.
No doubt in your mind?
I was there for one reason, sir.
Fair to say that you wanted
actually,
to
I was there for two reasons.
Situation.
The second reason was a personal reason, but we never spoke. The drug issue was on a personal reason, but it had nothing to do with Adam, and it had to do with a sexual assault.
It had nothing to do with Adam, but it still had something to do with possibly improving your legal situation.
It did not. Nothing will improve my legal situation but myself.
I have nothing further at this time, Your Honor.
If I could please, Your Honor, just to briefly clarify this thing.
With regards to your testimony here today, do you have any promises with the state about what's going to happen to your other charges based upon how you testify today?
Not at all.
Have you ever asked for any promises from the state in exchange for your testimony here today?
I have not.
You stated a moment ago on cross-examination that you said, I'm never going to be able to see him again. Can you please explain to the jury why, as somebody who's on parole or as a convicted felon, you're not going to be able to speak with him again, with somebody like him?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, I could never go to Valley Street because I've been to Valley Street. I did some time there, and you are not allowed to go to a jail that you have been to. Secondly, the prison. You have to be 10 years with no arrests, no convictions, 10 years when you've been outside the prison. And at this time, I definitely can't say that I've done that.
Let me ask you also, you were asked about meeting with the state, and then you were asked about a meeting in January 4th of 2023. On your meeting recently with the state, in that meeting, did you meet with myself and Attorney Knowles?
I did.
Okay. And was that recent, just before this trial began?
It was. It was, I think,
Maybe three Fridays ago. So we put it in January of 2024. Is that right?
That is right.
And yet, you were also asked about meeting with Detective Dunleavy. What year did that meeting take place?
Well, that was in 2022, and actually, I didn't even know he was coming. I was scheduled to meet with Manchester PD's sexual assault.
So that is a different matter, a
Correct.
Different time, and a different meeting.
Correct.
So when counsel a moment ago said that you met with the state prior to trial, these are two different meetings with two different groups of people and two different agencies, aren't they?
Absolutely.
Finally, with regards to the criminal record that defense counsel went through, was the defendant aware of your criminal record?
Absolutely.
Okay. And you were still friends with him, right?
I was still friends with him. I actually have not been charged with any new charges in quite some time for myself. Okay. I've been clean and sober and working on myself, which is what I plan to do when I get out. The same exact thing.
Understandable. With regards to also when you were asked about the defendant talking about this pooping incident, that Harmony would do this on purpose, Mm-hmm. I just want to clarify with regards to the timing. You were asked a moment ago whether that happened while Adam was in a car. Did the defendant...
We were on our way back from Medway, Massachusetts.
So that's what you meant by in the car.
Correct.
Not that the incident occurred in the car.
Correct.
And correct me, with regards to your testimony on direct, didn't you say on direct that it was after these incidents and this backhand incident, that's when he decided to bring her back to his mother, her mother?
It was the... I was told in the time of Thanksgiving 2019.
Thanksgiving 2019.
Correct.
Okay.
He packed, put her in the car and met her mother.
And who was it that told you that?
Adam Montgomery.
Thank you. No further questions at this time, Your Honor. Thank you, Ms. Maines.
Thank you.
So, Ms. Maines, I do want to clarify. It's your testimony that when you met with Detective Dunleavy January of last year, 2023, you were not trying to offer new ways to try and get information from Adam so as to improve your situation and get out of prison?
I was on a parole violation, sir. I got all of my time suspended. I didn't need your help to get out. All of my time was suspended upon entry into a program.
At the time that you had this second interview with Detective Dunleavy, mm-hmm. there was your parole situation, but you were facing the very same three charges that you're facing now, correct?
Yes, I was.
Okay. And we don't need to rehash them all again, but it was the Merrimack
charge.
Actually,
it was four. But...
that's right, out of Bedford.
Correct.
Okay. So those charges were all still pending then?
I just want to be honest. They are still pending. They were still pending then.
Okay, and again, what you're saying is that Adam told you that he had backhanded Harmony after she had her hand over, you think, Declan's mouth.
He did, yes.
And this was around Thanksgiving?
No. He returned her to her mother around Thanksgiving of 2019.
And that's what prompted her to do so, or
that,
him to do so?
It was an incident that we had spoken about coming home from Medway, yes.
And that's what prompted him to send her back to her mother?
Correct. He said that he just wanted to make sure that... he wanted to make sure that she had the proper care.
Ma'am, you are excused.
Thank you.
Any objection to her being excused?
Without objection.
Just please be careful of the
yes.
wires. State may call its next witness.
Captain, just please watch your step as you go through the board
sure.
there. And remain standing when you get to the podium, sir. Captain Larochelle, if you'd please go ahead and raise your right hand, sir. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you give this jury will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, I do.
Thank you, sir. Please feel free to have a seat. As we are being recorded for the record today, would you please state your full name and spell both your first and your last name for the record?
Sure. It's Matthew Larochelle, Larochelle. First name is Matthew, Matthew.
And Captain Larochelle, as we can probably guess from your title, where are you currently employed?
I currently work for the Manchester Police Department.
How long have you been working at the Manchester Police Department?
Been with the Manchester PD for approximately 24 years. I was hired in the year 2000.
In the year 2000?
Yes.
All right, thank you. I'm going to ask you to maybe scoot a little bit closer to that microphone, if you don't mind, just so we can make sure we can all hear you there. With regards to your time at the Manchester Police Department, are you a full-time certified officer through the state of New Hampshire?
Yes, I am.
And did you graduate from a Police Standards and Training Academy class?
Yes, I did.
Do you remember your academy number?
123rd.
123rd. Could you please go ahead and explain what are some of the different units and duties that you've been assigned while you've been at the Manchester Police Department throughout your career?
Sure. Like with any officer, I got hired in 2000. I spent about 3.5 or 4 years in patrol. I went from patrol to our community policing unit. I worked in CP for a couple of years. And then in 2007, I was assigned to our detective division as an investigator.
So detective in 2007?
Yes.
All right. And from there, I see that you're a captain now. How long did you spend at the detective unit, and when did you change ranks?
So I was a detective for about 7 years. In 2013, I got promoted to the rank of sergeant. I went back to the street as a street sergeant. Did about 3 years as a street sergeant in the patrol division. At what point I went to back to our juvenile investigative unit in 2015 as a supervisor, as a sergeant.
In 2015 in the juvenile unit?
Yes, sir.
And could you please just, for the jury's benefit, explain what type of criminal investigations does the juvenile unit conduct?
Sure. So the juvenile unit is part of the investigative division overall. We investigate crimes against children, specifically sexual and physical assaults against children.
So being there as a sergeant in 2015, what was your next change in rank and what unit did you work with?
So I worked in the juvenile unit until 2018. I was actually promoted in 2018 to lieutenant. I stayed in that unit. Again, that unit falls under the investigative division. So at that point, my role increased a little bit in the fact that I incorporated the domestic and sexual violence unit. So under the umbrella of investigative division, there's the juvenile unit and the domestic and sexual violence unit. Both units have their own sergeants. I got promoted to lieutenant and then oversaw both of those units at that time until my most recent promotion in 2022.
So with regards to being the lieutenant over the juvenile unit, and you said also the sexual assault unit at the time. You were there in 2019, 2020, 2021, and 2022, correct?
Yes, I was.
You said that you were promoted in 2022. At what rank did you get promoted to?
In 2022, I was promoted to captain, which is my current role. I oversee our community affairs division at this point.
And what does the community affairs division do?
Community affairs division encompasses community policing and our traffic unit. So essentially, neighborhood-specific concerns, concerns that the average patrol officer that's out handling calls and going call to call, if they can't focus on a neighborhood issue or a community issue, we can designate one of our 12 officers to go and handle that specific issue.
From the time that you were working in the juvenile unit, were you involved in the investigation into the disappearance of Harmony Montgomery?
Yes, I was.
What were some of the things that you did as part of that investigation? What were some of your duties there?
Obviously, when that call, when that report came into us, it was kind of an all-hands-on-deck type thing. Obviously, full resources of the police department and our partner agencies. My role was just general oversight, guidance. The detectives working on the case had their assignments, and we just there were several supervisors that oversaw that case. But just generally making sure the detectives doing the work had what they needed, coordination with other entities, other agencies throughout the state, local and state agencies that we worked with.
You talked about local and state agencies you worked with. Could you go ahead and kind of tell us about some of the different agencies that you were a liaison with for this investigation?
Sure. So we worked closely with state police. We worked with New Hampshire Fish and Game. Several searches that we conducted were with Fish and Game. They assisted us. We worked with federal partners. We had the FBI was involved, so we had folks from all kinds of different agencies in and out of our office for months. The U.S. Marshals Service had a designated deputy that was assigned to this investigation, and just kind of the liaison between everybody.
Okay. Did you ever work or liaison yourself with other agencies out of state or outside of federal government?
Yes, I did.
Okay. with regards to also some of the other duties that you've had on this case, was part of that at different times to listen to jail calls that were made?
Yes, it was.
From other individuals. And other times, were you asked to listen to other lawfully recorded calls that were made?
Yes, I was.
Okay. And finally, with regards to physical searches, what was your role in with regards to any physical searches that were made?
We did physical searches of many different locations throughout the city. We did searches of a wooded area on the west side. We did searches of the riverfront area on the north end of the city. We did searches of Bear Brook State Park, which is, if you're not familiar, just about a half an hour north of here. We did searches out of state that I was familiar with. I wasn't directly involved in those, but several searches throughout the course of a six-month period.
All right. I'd like to get to those, each one of those searches, but I want to start with kind of staying at home with regards to in Manchester. At any point during the investigation, did you have any contact with individuals at the Manchester School District about Harmony Montgomery?
Yes, I did.
And why did you do that?
I reached out to the school district just basically in the early days, early on in the investigation, to see what kind of contacts they might have had with Harmony, if she was ever enrolled in school or not.
Okay. And with regards to that, did you discover whether she was ever enrolled in school in the Manchester School District?
I discovered that she was not enrolled.
What about in any of their records for early enrollment programs for younger children?
They had no record of Harmony Montgomery or her date of birth in their system.
You talked about some of the searches that were conducted. I'd like to know, what searches for Harmony did you personally participate in?
I mentioned the West Side search. That was it's an area, a large wooded area, Rock Rimmon area, if you're familiar with that area on the west side of the city, behind Mount Calvary Cemetery. It's probably hundreds of acres. We searched over there after receiving tips that led us to that area. And there was also a search, as I mentioned, on the north end of the city along the Merrimack River.
Okay. You said a search along the Merrimack River.
Yes.
Where would that have been along the river?
It's an area off of North River Road, West River Drive. There's some apartment buildings in particular that led us to that area, and we searched a wooded area along the river, adjacent to the river.
Did you participate in any of the searches of 77 Guilford Street?
Somewhat. I was there. I was not directly overseeing that portion of the investigation, but I am familiar with it.
And what about an area known as Stark Park over near River Road?
Yes, that would be the area I'm speaking of as okay. Well. That's the Stark Park area.
That particular search, that Stark Park area, what, if anything, did you coordinate to make sure that search was done?
We had reached out. I had specifically reached out to New England Canine Recovery. That's an organization that has canine teams. Handlers with their canine partners that specifically search wooded areas they do search and recovery, but they also do they can do cadaver work as well.
And did you contact them to search those areas?
I did.
Were there any searches that were done in that area, not necessarily on land but on water?
There were. We searched with the assistance of New Hampshire Fish and Game. We searched the area of the Merrimack River. Again, if you're familiar with that area, it's the area of the dam, the Eversource Dam, and then it would have been northerly above the dam. We did a full-day search of that area.
Searching the dam, were you present for that search?
I was.
Okay.
And I was present by shore. I was not physically on the boats with Fish and Game, but I was in the area.
From shore, were you able to observe how that search of the dam was conducted?
I was.
And how was it conducted?
Fish and Game utilizes several of their officers in boats. They have teams. I can't accurately testify to what those consist of, but there's several people in the boat. For safety reasons, they have an officer that's hooked up to oxygen that they put in the water that can actually, they're actually dragged behind the boat while they're physically searching. They also have submersible robots that they can use as well, which they utilize that day.
Were you involved at all with the search over at 644 Union Street?
I was.
Okay. Were you present there for that search?
Yes, I was.
What were some of the other agencies that were present with you when that residence was searched?
Again, that would have been our federal partners. The Federal Bureau of Investigation was there. We had members of the Marshal Service, like I said, There may have been some state police there, I'm not sure, but several entities there. That was an entire day. We pretty much took over the entire block.
Just to clarify, was the Federal Bureau of Investigations, the FBI, part of that search as well?
Yes, they were.
I'd like to ask you, with your work in the juvenile unit, have you heard of an organization, sometimes also referred to as NCMEC or NCMEC?
Yes, I have.
And what is that, the NCMEC, what does that stand for? What is this organization?
So NCMEC is the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. They're a national organization that facilitates and organizes searches for, they assist law enforcement. We can call them with info, they can call us with info. I was basically the direct liaison between this investigation and that organization. I probably spent time on the phone with them at least once a week during this investigation.
Had you worked with them before for children who were missing or believed to be exploited?
I had.
And what was some of the information that you provided to them as part of your work with them to try to find harmony?
Specific to this case?
Yes.
We basically provided them any photos that we had. We asked them to do the same. And at one point when a DNA profile was identified for harmony, we provided that to them as well.
Did you ever personally reach out to National Center for Missing and Exploited Children about tips that they had generated that needed follow-up?
Yes, I did.
And I want to ask you about some of those tips. Did you ever receive a tip that Harmony was alive in a place called Surprise, Arizona?
Yes, we did.
What did you do to follow up on that tip?
So we got the information anonymously that Harmony was alive and attending a school in Surprise, Arizona. I personally reached out to that police department, tried to make contact with an officer. I think I spent 2 or 3 days working on that. Eventually, we were able to get an SRO, which is a school resource officer. School resource officers are typically assigned by municipalities to focus on schools. So they sent their school resource officer to that school to make contact with the person that that we had a photo of and actually made an eyes on identification.
So even though it's a town nowhere near New Hampshire, it's in Arizona, you still followed up on that lead?
Yes, I did.
Why?
We're working, again, it's an all-hands-on-deck investigation. We're working, it's the most important investigation we've ever worked on, and we're dealing with a 7-year-old missing child.
I can approach you.
Zoom in.
I'd like to show you to Mark State's Exhibit 101. Do you know this man?
Yes.
Who is it?
That's Adam Montgomery.
Have you seen him in person before?
Yes, I have.
Have you heard him speak before?
Yes, I have.
Have you heard him talk to other people before?
Yes, I have.
Can you recognize his voice in person?
I can.
And can you recognize his voice over the phone?
Yes.
Have you reviewed some lawfully recorded calls of his voice?
I have.
And with regards to those particular calls, I'm going to show you what's been marked State's Exhibit 156 for identification. I'd like to ask you whether or not you recognize that exhibit. Feel free to open up the envelope.
Yes, I do.
And what do you recognize that to be?
This is a disc containing a phone call made by Adam Montgomery, which I have listened to, and it actually has my signature on it.
Your signature?
Yes.
Now, let me ask you, with regards to that particular, it's got your signature on this disc itself?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, let me ask you, with regards to that particular call, is that an entire call, or is that a portion of a lawfully recorded call that you listened to?
I believe this is a portion of a call that's longer. It's an 8-minute call. I believe this is shorter than that.
Have you heard all of the original recorded call?
Yes, I have.
Okay. With regards to what you listened to on that particular CD, is that accurate in terms of that portion of the call that you heard originally is unchanged for the part of it that's on that CD?
That is accurate, yes, sir.
So that this is a small piece of the whole?
Correct.
Also, with regards to that call, separate from that, is there any sort of visual component to that call on that disc as you reviewed it? Basically, is there a transcript of what is said in the recording as you're listening?
Yes.
have you reviewed that transcript, the words that are on the page?
Yes, I have.
Is that accurate for that particular phone call?
Yes, it is.
Is it accurate for the identifying properly Adam Montgomery's voice?
Yes.
Is it accurate for identifying the generally that he was called another individual and that person's voice?
Yes.
This time, Your Honor, I'd ask the court to strike exhibit number 156 and be entered as a full exhibit.
Any objection?
Subject to the prior conference at the bench.
All right. The ID is stricken and it's entered as a full exhibit.
Thank you.
Detective Larochelle, with regards to this particular CD, I've preloaded the contents of this onto an area of the drive, and it's my understanding without defense objection, Your Honor, I'm going to play that recording now. What I would like you to do, please, Detective, is to be able to listen to the entire recording, and then I may have some questions for you as we go through, okay?
Okay.
Say full screen.
About halfway down.
One more, this it?
Yeah, I believe so.
Their time. Is that Adam Montgomery's voice?
Yes, it is.
With regards to the search by the river, I believe you just testified a moment ago on direct that there was a search by the river, correct?
Yes, there was.
And you also testified that there were searches involving the FBI. Is that also?
Yes.
Continue on.
You know, I'm sure they have to take everything that's said to them, no matter how outlandish, seriously, and they have to do their due diligence. But I can grasp that, right? But dude, my friend who died, who is cool as Adam, you don't even know what your friend's name was. It's probably bad. This person that was here, that was like, what the fuck? Even way to just waste taxpayer money, I guess, to like
When you heard the defendant say on there that they just wasted their time, you know, with regards to searches, were those some of the searches that you told us that you were involved in?
Yes.
And when you heard him describe in that call saying that it was just a way to waste taxpayers' money, dude, was that transcript accurate as to his words?
Yes.
When you heard the defendant say, just think about how much money you're wasting in an effort to prove something, is that part of the transcript accurate?
Yes, it is.
And is that what you heard said by Adam Montgomery?
Yes, it is.
And when you heard the defendant say, I get it, you're trying to prove a case, kudos to you, but at what cost, man? You're just going to chase down people from Arizona. Is that part of the transcript accurate?
Yes, it is.
And the tip that you described for us a moment ago that you worked on from Surprise, Arizona, is that the tip that you chased down?
Yes, it is.
Do you agree with what the defendant said in the call, that your work to find Harmony was a waste of time and money?
We have an objection. Hold on. The objection sustained.
Captain Larochelle, with regards to the transcript that you've just taken us through, is that a fair and accurate account of the defendant's statements as you recognize them to be?
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Captain. I have no further questions for you. Defense may.
No questions.
All right, sir, you may step down.
Thank you.
Your Honor, with that, the state rests.
All right, counsel, just approach for just 1 minute.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know there have been a lot of stops and starts today, and part of what I was discussing with the lawyers at the bench is what's most prudent so that we're respectful of your time as we can be. The state has now rested their case. So for tomorrow, there will be a determination as to whether or not the defense wishes to present any evidence. As I've already told you before, the defendant has no obligation to prove his innocence in this case. The burden is on the state to prove his guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. So if the defense wishes to, they may present evidence, but they may choose not to. That is their right. Should they decide that they wish to present evidence, that would happen tomorrow. We would begin there. And then beyond that, it would be time for closing arguments and final instructions. So that's where we are. So I'm going to release you for the day today, for the rest of the day. I'm going to have you come back tomorrow morning at 9:45. Okay, so we'll have a 10 a.m. start. I'll ask you to come back tomorrow at 9:45 a.m., a little bit later. I really want to try to see if we can make sure that we've done all the business that needs to be done and that we're ready for you at 10 a.m. Once again, I cannot stress strongly enough, you are not to read anything about this case, not watch any news about the case, don't read anything in the papers or on social media, anywhere else on the internet. You're not to discuss the case with each other or with anyone else. Don't do any independent research. Don't drive by any of the locations. As has been the case throughout this trial, the lawyers have been instructed they're not to communicate with you. So please, once again, don't hold it against them if they pass you in the hallway without acknowledging your presence. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. We will see you tomorrow morning at 9:45. All rise for the jurors, please. You may be seated. All right.
I'm sorry, I had to grab my indictments.
That's okay.
At this time, I'd like to make a motion to dismiss certain charges presented, charged against Adam Montgomery. The first comes to the second degree assault. I recognize that the information with regard to the assault is based on witnesses reporting statements by Adam Montgomery. There is no eyewitness, including Kayla Montgomery herself, because we did know that Mr. Tseros did speak with Ms. Montgomery, and as a result of that conversation did not come away with concerns with regard to a need to follow up on the allegation of assault by Kevin Montgomery. Follow-up was deemed necessary. This allegation was investigated, Harmony was spoken to, witnesses were spoken to, and nothing happened as far as this investigation, and that the charges here occurred after, that were instituted after a search for Harmony Montgomery and determination that Adam Montgomery was at least a suspect in why Harmony was missing, and that was the impetus that led to his charge in this case, but based on the facts as they existed in the summer of 2019, I do not believe that there was support for the allegation, and subsequent charges against Mr. Montgomery don't make what did not exist as a confirmation now to be confirmation. With regard to the second degree murder, the only evidence with regard to how Harmony died or who killed Harmony is Kayla Montgomery's testimony. Kayla Montgomery is a convicted perjurer. She has also acknowledged two other instances of perjury other than what she was charged with. Her story itself went through various iterations, and quite frankly, I think were pretty ludicrous as far as a degree of violence that nobody could accomplish in public as she had described and not be seen by anyone. She was describing a degree of violence in the car at a time when people would be going perhaps to work at Colonial Village. She was describing assaults in the car outside of the clinic on Franklin Street. And you may recall the testimony that at one point prior to that, there was testimony that they had to go into the clinic one at a time because at a prior visit while they were parked outside of the clinic, somebody noted that there was nobody in the car with the kids. And so that's why they changed their behavior to one person at a time. This was the regular hours of the clinic with people going in and out of the clinic. Very, very public area. The jury was at the scene. Obstructions for the car outside of the clinic didn't exist. Then there is allegations of at traffic lights from the clinic to Burger King, assaults. She claims at every traffic light. She claims that Mr. Montgomery was at those traffic lights leaning over and striking Harmony in the back seat several times through each, perhaps each traffic light, and that the last time was pulling into the Burger King parking lot. Again, the jury saw the Burger King parking lot, no obstructions, at a time when other people would be going in and out of the Burger King parking lot. And she described that based on that final assault, he became worried that something perhaps was wrong. And then she describes pulling into the drive-in, having communication and contact, direct contact with a clerk who he is providing money to receive, or however it was paid. She fought cash but couldn't say definitively, and then receiving the food as the clerk is handing it out to him while he is sitting in the car. I just think it defies logic, reason, and any sort of credibility. The changes that she went through with regard to those events, that although she started out saying that these assaults to the jury started at in the morning before going to the clinic, on cross-examination said that they actually started between 2 and 3 in the morning, with about Harmony being struck about 15 times. And one of the other things in the Burger King parking lot, that she thought the boys were asleep throughout this time. She wasn't sure. I think her credibility with regard to that information is just, she has no credibility, and therefore there is no evidence of how Harmony died and who caused her death. And I would move to dismiss the second-degree murder charge for insufficient evidence, even taking the evidence in the light most reasonable to the state. With regard to falsifying physical evidence, I have no motion. With regard to abuse of a corpse, I have no motion. With regard to tampering with the witness, Kayla testified that upon discovering Harmony's death, she and Adam spoke about what to do. They spoke together about concerns that DCYF would take the children, that was her concern as well, that they made plans together to hide the body, to not tell about Harmony's death. And her description on cross, because I understand on direct it was different, but on cross she acknowledged a plan and a communication as a partnership and conspirator rather than being a victim of witness tampering. So I would move to dismiss that charge as insufficient evidence taken in the light most reasonable to the state.
Okay.
Your Honor, what defies logic, reason, and credibility is to argue that in the evidence, and taking the evidence in the light most favorable to the state, that this matter should not go on to the juries. And the defendant's motion to now should be dismissed. I would like to remind the court, with regards to the testimony of the second degree assault that occurred, Kevin Montgomery testified about how he came home from his trip to Florida to see see Harmony in the kitchen the day that he returns in July, in the time period alleged between July 7th and July 22nd, and that he sees the black eye on Harmony. Plain visual assurance and seeing that this injury occurred on a five-year-old girl at the time, and that what was the defendant's response? I bashed her around the fucking house. This statement about the defendant having struck Harmony during that time period was confirmed by the testimony of Ms. Katie Morin, Courtney Garcia, by Kayla Montgomery herself, by Nicholas Ahern, who all either saw the injury or heard the defendant say one of his variations. One, admitting that he struck Harmony. Two, saying that Harmony got hurt in a soccer incident. Or three, admitting that he struck Harmony and that he was angry at the time. Mr. Demetrius Saros, the DCYF investigator who responded, was able to get there over a week later after the defendant had spirited Harmony away at the time of the very first visit, and even he still saw the mark on Harmony's face weeks later. The fact that the defense counsel just pointed out that this charge came forward post the original search for Harmony going missing is completely irrelevant. The statute of limitations allows this charge to be brought any time within the time frame for an ordinary felony. Specifically here also, when you have a child, there's an extension to the statute of limitations that would go out for felony level conduct. There is no basis in law nor in fact of any of the witnesses who have testified to be able to dismiss this charge. With regard to the second degree murder, again, the testimony of Kayla Montgomery alone is sufficient for this matter to go forward to the jury for their consideration, but it is not alone. It is accompanied by copious amounts of corroboration from various different witnesses, physical evidence that's been provided, from testimonial evidence about records that what she said happened to Kayla happened to Harmony did in fact happen. And that even though the defendant now has stated to the jury in the opening arguments that they can and should find him guilty of falsifying physical evidence. It's falsifying physical evidence that would have shown that he committed the crime of second-degree murder against her. Not that something happened in the middle of the night, but that he struck her on December 7th. His words, "I think I hurt her this time. I think I did something." That's something that's been testified to, that the Kayla Montgomery testified and talked about in the very first proffer, that the first punching happened before the sun came up. So representations that though the beginning of the assault must have been seen by somebody else that was there on a cold, dark December morning they do not go ahead and meet with the facts of the case that have been presented on the situation that she was in. The description of violence that was made in public, it's very easy to be violent towards a five-year-old who's laying down in a car seat, laying down in the car. And that is, in fact, the position that Kayla Montgomery puts Harmony in, which is behind her seat, behind the passenger seat, in the rear, down against the door. With regards to the witness tampering charge, Your Honor, for that, not only does a picture speak 1,000 words over the fact that the defendant abused Kayla Montgomery physically to make sure that she stuck to the story, but that abuse, as been testified to, was witnessed by Nicole Giles as early as January 2020, as well as later on in 2021 by Tara Hilbert. The testimony of Kayla Montgomery has been that that was done to make sure that she stuck to the story that the defendant created, that she did not come out. And she stuck to that story so well, she went ahead and committed perjury as part of that story. So to say that there's no evidence that when looking at the evidence in the light most favorable to the state, to say that there is no evidence for these three charges to go forward does not coincide with the facts that we've actually heard in this courtroom. And as a result, the defendant's motion should be dismissed.
All right, to succeed on a sufficiency of the evidence claim, the defendant must show that viewing the evidence in the light most favorable to the state, no rational trier of fact could find guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. All reasonable inferences derived from the evidence are viewed in the light most favorable to the state. With regard to the second degree assault charge, Kevin Montgomery testified that he saw the black eye. The defendant, according to the testimony, the defendant admitted that he had bashed Harmony around the house. Kayla also heard the statements. Others also saw the bruising on Harmony. Mr. Soros saw the defendant removing Harmony from the scene when he went there, and subsequently also saw the bruising himself. So considering the evidence that's been presented and taking all the inferences and facts in light most favorable to the state, the motion to dismiss that charge is denied. With regard to the second-degree murder charge, as the state says, there is direct evidence through the testimony of Kayla Montgomery that she saw the defendant striking Harmony, which led to her death. The defendant's own statements indicate that at the time he believed that he hurt Harmony or that he did something to her. There's additional descriptions regarding the circumstances surrounding the families living in the car at that time. Again, taking all the facts and testimony and inferences in the light most favorable to the state, the court does find that the state meets its burden. And the motion to dismiss on the second degree murder charge is also denied. With regard to the witness tampering, there is a photograph of Kayla. Kayla testified extensively regarding the allegations of abuse and the statements by the defendant with respect to convincing Kayla to stick with the story that he had given to her. Nicole Giles and Tara Hilbert both testified quite clearly regarding the abuse that they saw and heard about. And again, there is sufficient evidence that to show that the state has met its burden on the witness tampering charge as well. And so the motion to dismiss on that claim is also denied. All right. So the motions to dismiss have been denied. I think we're ready to go forward tomorrow with the defense presentation of evidence if they wish to present any. Attorney Smith, it may be useful for the court and for the state for us, if you know in advance about whether or not we're going to be moving right into closings or whether you anticipate presentation of evidence, if you're comfortable with it, you can let the state and the court know. Otherwise, what I would have you do is be here no later than 8:30 tomorrow morning so that we know where this is headed. Should the defendant refuse to be transported tomorrow, the court would deem that a waiver of his right both to be present and a waiver of his right to testify. So I want to be clear on that, as I said to him when I did colloquy him on this issue of his absence. If he doesn't get on the transport in the morning, he will be waiving both his right to be present and his right to testify. Any question about that?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. And if there is any issue with your ability to see him, please inform the court immediately. Okay. With regard to the pending motion that was filed over the weekend, Attorney, I'm comfortable just ultimately making a ruling on that. Since I just got the state's objection this morning, I don't want to rule on it from the bench right now. But I think you can all be prepared as you would for closings.
With regard to that motion, I did want to point out something in light of the state's objection.
Okay.
That it is not a, while we put in the motion the court's order on sequestration, this motion, and disagree with it, this motion is about the exculpatory evidence, Brady violation. Also, we did have a transcript so that when we put something in quotes, it is our from the recording, not from notes. And finally, that there was one thing where a representation that Attorney Garrity was not sure about whether or not he received some of the information from another source, his wife. In our transcript as well, he is quite clear that the issue of being asked to alert Kayla on being alone, as we put in our motion, that he was quite clear on that, and he was not clear about the second issue that he may have gotten it from his wife about conceding the other charges.
And I guess the only issue that I suppose I'll give you a chance to clarify now is your notion of what is exculpatory. Why don't you tell me in your own words rather than have me attempt to state it exactly what is exculpatory?
The fact that she was specifically guided towards an area and so that she might prepare. And in fact, she did say that once she got the information, she used that information to...
So the fact that she was informed by the state that you were going to... That essentially you were going to suggest that she was the one who killed Harmony. That's what you consider to be...
We don't consider that to be new information to her.
Right.
However, that the specific direction was being alone in the car that night with the children.
So essentially what you think is exculpatory is the preparation of a witness subsequent to opening statements?
Yes.
Okay.
Not disclosing it, especially because the state prepared a question based on their own request to Attorney Garrity, and then said they were surprised at her answer, where it's clear that they anticipated that answer, and then failed to disclose that that guidance had actually been requested.
Okay. Anything, I do have your extensive responsive pleading, but if you'd like to
just
respond
briefly,
now.
Just briefly, Your
yes.
Honor, with regards to what we just heard a moment ago.
Yes.
The state prepared the questions there not based upon the answer of Attorney Garrity, but actually based upon the question of defense counsel during her cross-examination. And in that, she made a statement to Caleb Montgomery to say that basically you went ahead and you agreed and you had to come up big time to get rid of bigger charges and agreed that you had committed lesser charges. That is the prompting for why the state asked its question on redirect to point out that that was the same legal theory that the defendant was using himself, so that defense counsel was very familiar with the theory. It wasn't about a conversation that was had with Attorney Garrity. It was about the defendant's questioning on cross-examination the day before. When we came back,
can you repeat that? The defendant's questioning.
Yes, Your Honor, I apologize. I don't have that right in front of me, and I should have printed it out. But at one point in time, actually, excuse me for a second, Your Honor. I believe I may have taken a note on this. Point, defense counsel asked asked Ms. Montgomery, saying, "You knew they had you solid on perjury, right? You were never getting around that one, right? And so you decided that this would probably be the best that you could do to get as few consequences for your own actions as possible." That is the prompting for the state's question on redirect that was with regards to whether or not the witness was aware of defendant's statements in opening and concessions, specifically concessions in opening, about the falsifying physical evidence charge and about the abuse of the corpse charge. That is the prompting for the reason, not because of a conversation that was had with Attorney Garrity. It was about those concessions, and it was about defense counsel's question that prompted this to be asked, to then come up, or to then have heard Ms. Montgomery's response. I think that the state has articulated, hopefully clearly enough in its response, that regardless of even if there had been a specific conversation that was about this is the full details of something happening in the middle of the night, if that was there, that would not have been a violation of the sequestration order, nor is it new information that would have been shared with Ms. Montgomery. Nor would she have been prohibited from having it, and nor does that equal a violation of Brady under O'Brien. There is nothing new here. The defendant's argument is essentially that opposing party preps a witness, all of that should be discoverable, and it's not. If there's a suggestion to the witness of how to testify, that may be an issue with regards to what the substance is, but not testimony in general. To be able to remember that at all times, the most important thing is to tell the truth, to make sure that you understand the answer to the question being asked before you give an answer, to make sure that you use your own words to answer a question and don't accept an attorney's words, regardless of which table they happen to be standing at. That is not some sort of suggestive information, and providing that information to a witness is not something that is then in exchange. Something that is exculpatory for the defendant or is somehow sharing information for the witness. It's not a surprise to Kayla Montgomery that the defendant would be arguing that she's the one who killed Harmony, since those are some of the exact same questions that she was asked from investigators at the beginning, even back to the very first proffer, was about establishing that she's not the individual who had done this. So here, the opposing party doesn't need to say everything that was discussed with the witness and witness prep. That's not Brady material. And what the defendant's argument is to try to say that somehow a violation of a sequestration order, which did not happen, then generates exculpatory material in Brady. And it's I'm sorry, but that's not the case. That's not how Brady operates. That's not how the sequestration order operates.
All right, thank you. And again, I think it might be on there, but there is a point where Attorney Knowles said, I don't believe I asked anything of Attorney Garrity. And Attorney Garrity, in fact, said, I was contacted to and requested to apprise Kayla.
Right. I heard him to say, though, that he wasn't requesting information from Attorney Garrity. And Attorney Garrity testified that he just spoke to her when she was here that morning. So in any event, I don't think there was no apprising of testimony. I hear what you're saying. I've read your motion. I'll reread it. I'll reread the state's response of pleading.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else on that, Attorney Smith?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Okay. I know you have another commitment. Attorney Brooks, did you have some language you wanted to give me for the proposed instructions that I gave to you regarding the defendant's absence, or I wasn't sure whether you were just saying?
I have not drafted anything myself, Your Honor.
It's something beyond the standard instruction about if the defendant chooses not to testify.
Oh,
you want something specific to his his absenting himself throughout the trial?
That should play no role in the jury's consideration. That itself does not constitute evidence, and the jury should not speculate.
Okay.
And that's fine with the state, Your Honor. We have no objection to adding that language.
Okay. Was there anything else other than that you wanted changed?
No, Your Honor.
Okay, and you've reviewed the instructions on the charges themselves?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Anything from the state other than that?
No, not at all, Your Honor. We reviewed the instructions ourselves. We reviewed the jury verdict form. We have no other suggestions or alterations. Thank you.
Okay. I just want to make sure that I've covered. Okay.
And I don't mean to be disrespectful.
No. I know you do have to accomplish something. Okay. Can you just approach for just one more moment?
Yes, right? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.